some years ago. The Normandy community asked the Benedictines to give our annual liturgy. She was a scripture scholar, expert on the Psalms. In one of her conferences, she suggested that the key to understanding the Sunday scriptures is often the responsibility of the Psalm. And today, I'd like to follow her advice and begin with that refrain. If today you hear his voice, harden not your heart. When the Bible speaks of a heart, it is never talking about a Valentine heart, and only seldom referring to the organ that pumps blood throughout our body. Rather, for both the Old and New Testaments, the heart is the core of the person, the center that makes you you. It is where you keep your values, your valuables. Thus you read, where your treasure is, there your heart will be. Or in the case of Mary, twice we are told, she treasured these things in her heart. So when the psalmist says, harden not your heart, he's asking us to not just listen with our ears, but to open the core of who we are, to hear and ponder what God would speak to us. I suggest that same invitation applies to today's readings. First, there is Ezekiel, called to be a watchman, who sounds the alarm, urging the Israelites to repent of their sins, remember what God has done, and once again, open their hearts to his call, lest they have to pay the price of their infidelity. These are prophetic words spoken right before the destruction of Jerusalem and the Babylonian exile. In a letter to the Romans, Paul reminds his readers that the one who loves another, who does no evil to their neighbor, has fulfilled the law. So there follows the imperative, owe nothing to anyone except to love one another. These first few readings, and their call to harden by their heart, set the stage for today's passage from Matthew. Here, Jesus talks about what is perhaps the most difficult part of loving someone, namely our heavy but real responsibility, and to face being hurt by another, by a spouse who has been unfaithful, or a friend who has broken the confidence, to take the initiative and confront the one who has sinned against us. Rather than holding it all in and seeing with resentment, or only talking about my hurt with a third party, Jesus says we should confront the offender directly and tell him or her what they have done. It's all to happen behind closed doors, no public embarrassment, but the cards must be put on the table. To add a personal word, in my experience, I am much more likely to hear, let alone listen to, a word of rebuke that comes from someone who I'm sure loves me, and who has affirmed and commended me, and I know in my heart is only seeking what is good for me. Back to the text. If this first confrontation doesn't work, the Lord says we should bring in a second or third party to bear witness to the truth. Walk in daily school to keep the matter quiet. Only if both these steps fail, do we bring things out into the open and put the matter before the church. But what if even this strategy fails, and the offender will not even listen to the larger community? Then Jesus says, treat him or her as a Gentile or tax collector. Let the offender know that they have broken a basic bond that is needed to keep the community together, and so it must go. himself for herself and has become an outsider. But can we leave it there? Throughout this ministry, how did Jesus treat Gentiles and tax collectors? He healed the daughter of a Gentile woman, drank water from the Samaritan woman's cup, and actually called the tax collector to be one of the 12. I don't think it's unreasonable to say that Jesus always left the door open. Indeed, he reached out to those whom the many would cast aside. This sign of heaven states there's always room for reconciliation, which especially for a believer is a call to correct with compassion and receive correction with grace. A final question. On this weekend dedicated to racial healing, how might today's remains apply? If a brother or sister offends a whole group of people whose only difference from them is the color of the other person's skin, you have an obligation to try to heal, or at least begin to heal, such brokenness? Surely the answer has to be yes. Of course, we begin with a commitment to avoid self-righteous judgment. This is especially true if we are to confront what many have called America's original sin, namely that fundamental brokenness that is the given into which we are born, a brokenness rooted in black slavery, the sin that has marked our history since 1619, when the first black slaves arrived in Virginia. This is the beginning into which each of us was born. The residue of slavery in the Jim Crow world that continued in its aftermath, this is what many have called systemic racism, which, even after the civil rights laws passed in the 1960s, has not been totally uprooted from our land. But in the final analysis, racial harmony requires more than external laws. It is only possible with a change on the inside, which can only happen if we again and again